Hi, I'm Monica Jones, and here's the best in German cinema on DWTV's Kino. Here are the new releases we'll be screening on today's show.
Changing roles. A German star moves behind the camera. Real life. The best new documentaries. The Three Investigators. A kids' classic hits the screen.
I really want to direct. A lot of actors say it, but only few manage the move behind the camera. Not so with German actress Maria Schrader. For her directorial debut, she's picked an unusual story and setting, the adaptation of an Israeli bestseller about love in the Middle East.
Ya'ara, a young married woman, falls in love with Ariel, a childhood friend of her father. Her yearning turns to obsession, her lust to submission. Love Life is based on the bestseller by Israeli author Zeruya Shalev. The film marks the directing debut of German actress Maria Schrader. The book inspired her to switch roles. She describes the story as unputdownable.
Es hat mich getroffen und ich konnte
It touched me.
Yara in ihrer ganzen
I could understand and empathize with Yara and all her contradictions and her chaos.
Und in ihrem Chaos begreifen und fühlen auch. Und so sehr man um sie fürchtet,
regardless of how much you worry about her and keep thinking, what the hell is she doing, you somehow retain confidence in her. Because she's so ingenious and she's actually describing herself doing these things she can't stop herself doing.
Und was, wenn wir Fremde wären? Wenn ich eine Anhalterin wäre?
Sie sind doch hoffentlich nicht so ein Perverser, oder?
Also das ist ja eigentlich etwas, wonach
It's something that people are always looking for. When you go to the movies or open a book, you want to be enraptured by something and forget yourself. Then you snap out of it and something's changed.
Und irgendwas hat sich verändert.
That doesn't happen to me very often and I'm always looking for it.
Selten und ich sehne mich eigentlich immer wieder danach.
Maria Schrader and Zeruya Shalev first met while the author was on a book tour for Love Life. And the two have since become friends. Schrader was initially up for the lead role, but then she decided instead to direct. She shot the film on location in Israel.
First time I saw it, I was crying from the beginning till the end. I just couldn't stop crying. I was so moved by it. And you know, I never try to think what's the differences between the book and the movie, and if I would have done something differently. I accept it as it is.
Yara's sexual obsession leads to the revelation of a family secret. Her erotic adventure meant breaking taboos for director Maria Schrader and newcomer Netta Gatti.
I was very scared of being I don't know, overexposed. She was very elegant and nice and warm with me. She's a woman too, and she knows, and she's an actress too, and she knows how much fear is involved in such work.
Ich kenne den Grund nicht mehr für deine Traurigkeit, und ich weiß auch nicht, wieso du auf einmal so glücklich bist. Ich weiß nur, es hat alles nichts mit mir zu tun.
Yara seems bent on self-destruction. Meanwhile, Israel is engulfed in turmoil of its own.
Israel has a very strong presence, and I was a bit concerned about how they will deal with this strong presence and still keep the story very intimate. But when I saw the movie, I could understand their decision to shoot in Israel and to give kind of Israeli context.
The conflict in Israel is more palpable in the film than in the book.
Ich glaube, wenn man in Israel lebt, kann man sich der
Situation I think that if you live in Israel, you're always conscious of the situation in the country. It's like everyone's holding their breath. Life has a different edge.
Ein anderer Biss im Leben. Eine andere,
There's not only a different kind of vigilance, people are also emotionally guarded.
Situationen, die sich ihnen bieten,
when a chance arises, they grab it. They don't waste time like perhaps we would.
In a series of sensual images, Schrader shows how far her heroine goes to find herself.
Like living on the edge, makes you more daring. We don't know what will happen tomorrow. Maybe we will not survive, so we shouldn't wait.
Love Life marks what is surely a second career in directing for Maria Schrader.
If you love documentaries, you shouldn't miss the Leipzig Film Festival. The East German city has been a mecca for non-fiction fans for 50 years, and Leipzig remains a must for both established documentary directors and the new generation.
The 50th anniversary of the Leipzig Documentary Film Festival is a prime opportunity to look back at its roots during the era of East German communism. Director Thomas Heiser has been attending the festival since the 1970s.
Leipzig was exciting because there were so many films you wouldn't otherwise see.
At the time, censorship was harsh. The festival was meant to demonstrate openness, but it wasn't allowed to criticize the East German system, a difficult balancing act for its organizers. And then there was the forced fraternity with the GDR's communist neighbors.
For many years, I think it was from 73 to 80, there was this so-called self-selection, where the socialist brother countries sent their films. And it was clear that these films from Moscow or Budapest or wherever had to be screened.
1989, a year of sweeping political upheaval. Most of the films for Leipzig were completed at the last minute. The dominant theme was the fall of the Berlin Wall and the newfound freedom. Thomas Heiser continues to take advantage of that freedom. His films touch on sore spots, both political and social.
Enjoy the film. I hope if anyone's still outside, they'll get in too.
Heiser's latest documentary is about Tommy, a 16-year-old. He's a high school dropout who ends up in a home for so-called troubled children. He has problems with his family, especially his mother. Yet, as soon as he moves into the home, he hangs up family photos.
Na, wir kommen früh zur Schule. Da haben wir noch die erste Stunde frei, bis um 8. Dann kommt der Lehrer rein, versucht was zu erzählen. Da sagen die ganzen Mitschüler, wir haben keinen Bock auf dem Scheiß. Und dann sagt die, na los, gehen wir Karten spielen oder Tischtennis. Und dann, unser ganzer Tag besteht nur aus Tischtennis dort.
Tommy's mother is a bus driver. She was 16 when she had him. Now she has two other children. She's given up on her eldest. Heiser is gentle in his observations of his protagonists and their surroundings. It's their inability to express what they feel that touches the viewer most.
I don't know any other way to tell stories, and I don't want to. I don't want to arrive somewhere with a preconceived idea and then shoot pictures for it. Rather, it's a voyage of discovery. That means being open to people that I don't actually know.
Dass man in der Pubertät nicht unbedingt seine Mutter als Gesprächspartner hat, ist ja nun auch nichts Neues.
Manchmal möchte ich da gehen, da einen Kuss geben, dann dreht die sich immer gleich weg.
Echt?
Ja. Oder wenn ich die drücken würde, so, dann hat sie ihr Telefon im Ohr oder so. Keine Ahnung, deswegen gehe ich da schon gar nicht mehr hin.
Sag mal andersrum.
The film was awarded the Leipzig Festival's Silver Dove Award. Showing things as they are is also the goal of Ibtissam Saleh Marana, a Palestinian filmmaker from Israel. Her theme is the hopeless situation of Arab women in the Palestinian territories.
I have to make documentary films about women, about troubles, about identity, about politics, occupation, and about Arab society.
Ibtissam observes a Palestinian woman from the Gaza Strip. Her husband, an Israeli Arab, divorces her and she loses her children. Under Islamic law, men get custody of children and the Israeli officials don't consider it their jurisdiction.
هم أخذوا مني أولادي ورفضين يعطوني إياهم.
أنا وش بفهم إنه أنت معك هوية إسرائيلية.
أي نعم.
مزبوط. لما نحن تلفنا حكم على الساعة 10 للمحكمة. شو اللي بصير هون؟
The director becomes an ally of this woman and helps her fight. They even attempt to kidnap the children. The camera is always close to the action, showing this woman's futile situation. She refuses to give up the battle to get her children back.
هسه صار لي في المكلاة شهرين ونص تقريبا بالضبط. شهرين ونص. بعد عن الأولاد و...
Ibtisam is also a fighter and her weapon is her camera. She says as long as conditions in her country don't change, she won't address any other topics. The same could be said for Thomas Heiser and his film about people in Eastern Germany. The 50th Leipzig Documentary Film Festival featured many films by directors who point a camera at things others look away from.
For our shortcuts, we have a pack of young up-and-comers and two veterans trying something new.
This year's German short film prizes were awarded in a ceremony at the Film and Television Academy in Potsdam. The top prize, carrying a cash award of 30,000 euros, went to director Lukas Miko for Das gefrorene Meer, The Frozen Sea. It tells the story of Marco. His Christmas begins with a nightmare. His father takes off, as he has before, leaving the family.
Wo ist Papa?
Pass auf, da sind überall Scherben.
Wo ist Papa?
Arbeiten.
Das stimmt nicht. Papa hat mir versprochen, dass er hier bleibt.
Pass auf die Scherben auf, habe ich gesagt, du verletzt dich sonst.
Ich will jetzt wissen, wo Papa ist.
Hör auf!
Marco goes off in search of his father and discovers his secret. The domestic drama is told in just 25 minutes. For the director, such brevity is a narrative challenge.
To accurately depict the viewpoint of a small child within a very complex family structure, reducing, that's what making short films teaches you.
Unfortunately, short films rarely reach a wider cinema audience. But now, with additional funding for distribution, German Culture Minister Bernd Naumann intends to change that. The steppes of Kazakhstan. Frenchman Charles flees here to escape his former life. He's detained for espionage on the oil fields and taken to Astana. Veteran director Volker Schlöndorff depicts the Kazakh capital like something from a sci-fi movie.
Utopian city in the steppes, where there aren't even the people to live there. I don't think there's a better image for human hubris, which is, of course, what he's fleeing. Now he really knows why he wants to go to the desert.
Charles meets Uljan, a nomad who becomes his companion. Shy glances signal a growing friendship between the two. The film achieves its effects almost entirely without dialogue, very different from Schlöndorff's previous work.
The result is something like freestyle. It should be light and not try to prove anything, but should contain a breath of life.
Uljan portrays the confrontation between nomadic life and the Western world. A timeless film with melancholic and beautiful imagery. Rosa von Braunheim is celebrating his 65th birthday this week. His filmmaking career spans some 70 productions. His newest film is a documentary about his own childhood. Shortly before she died, his mother revealed to him that he was adopted. The director has always been interested in women's lives. This film observes the lives of three women in New York.
I don't believe there are any average people. When you really ask questions and go down deep, everyone is unusual, especially in New York. New York is a city that makes everyone interesting.
In New York in the 1970s, Braunheim worked alongside artists such as Andy Warhol. He was inspired by the flamboyant transvestite scene. His own crazy and sexually liberated life became fodder for his films. In Germany, he's campaigned for more openness towards homosexuality and has become a figurehead of the gay movement.
Of course I took a lot of flack. I wouldn't do it again today. But I think if you're working towards emancipation, you have to throw stones now and again.
Rosa von Braunheim has no intention of retiring, and he has more projects lined up once the birthday celebrations are over.
Germany hasn't got much of an indie film scene, but it has the Reading Twins. Dominik and Benjamin made their self-financed debut in 1999 with Oi! Warning, a skinhead love story that won awards all around the world. Now the Reading brothers are back with another entirely unique and critically acclaimed new film.
Gibt heute so verdammt selten richtige Penner hier. Ich meine Penner, die schwul sind. Scheiße fressen.
For the Unknown Dog was inspired by real-life events in eastern Germany. It opens with a scene of senseless violence. After committing a brutal murder, Bastian is forced to flee his tormented conscience. He joins a group of craftsmen who have embarked on their traditional wandering, a tradition that dates back to the Middle Ages.
Wir sind zwei zünftig Reisende. Steinmetz der eine, Betonbauer der andere. Für 3 Jahre und 1 Tag auf Wanderschaft.
The directors use opulent images to portray this hidden world where the journey is the key to breaking out of modern society.
Das war doch ein Witz. Kein Handy auf Wanderschaft.
Nein!
Benjamin and Dominik Reding spent 4 years making the film. They wrote the screenplay, and when they failed to find a production company, they did that themselves too.
It's exciting to tell a story with unusual images, unusual people, unusual situations, and unusual dialogue, like you find on these craftsmen's journeys with their own language. I'm always interested in strange things, new things. When this story first came to light in East Germany, where one of 3 kids brutally killed another, we began looking into what can really change a person. And a journey, a wandering, is something that can really change a person.
Wanderschaft ist etwas, was Menschen wirklich verändert.
Also wohin? Weg. Einfach nur weg. Wo es besser ist.
Du Kopf, ich zahl. Okay?
Bastian joins Festus for the journey. A story of male bonding begins.
Hey, Hamburg!
Mann, hast du ein Glück gehabt!
Bastian and Festus embark on the journey, but tensions are never too far from the surface.
Aus mit der Wanderschaft, weil du hier ein amputierter Kackrümel nicht aufgepasst hast.
It's not about longing to go on a journey. I don't think we'd have managed to make a film about that. Writing a film always requires a bit of critical distance, otherwise it becomes a heroic epic. And I don't write epics, nor does my brother.
The Reding brothers allow their characters to evolve slowly and carefully, a technique they already employed in their debut, Oi! Warning. It's an unusual love story about a skinhead whose macho ideals fall apart when he falls in love with a punk. The movie reaped public and critical acclaim, but making a film about a gay skinhead proved a dangerous proposition.
We don't just go and look at things from the outside. We got inside the scene to check it out. And to do that, we had to accept certain risks, like being punched in the face by skinheads.
Nein, will er nicht. Der Kunde ist tot. Mein Reisekamerad, Schmiegel. Unfall, haben die Bullen gesagt. Letztes Jahr in Wismar.
Bastian finds out that the man he killed was the best friend of Festus. He feels he's expected to fill his shoes.
We always wanted to make the kind of films which don't exist and which I think are lacking at the movies.
Oh. For the Unknown Dog breaks new ground in German cinema, and its visuals, shot in CinemaScope, are often breathtaking. For their next project, the two are planning an international co-production, Golem und die Zweifache Welt, which translates as Golem and the Parallel World, a fantasy film set in Prague. The Redings hope the success of The Unknown Dog will ensure they get the funding they deserve to put their unique vision on screen.
The Three Investigators is a series of children's detective stories that were created in America but have lived on in Germany. Justice, Peter and Bob have been the heroes of generations of German kids. Now their adventures are getting the big screen treatment.
The life of a young detective can be a dangerous one. The film kicks off with an action sequence worthy of a James Bond movie.
So sure this investigating business was a good idea.
Making The Three Investigators was a childhood dream come true for director Florian Baxmeier.
Was mich als Kind fasziniert hat, natürlich vor allen Dingen an Justus, dass
What fascinated me when I was a kid, especially about Justus, was that he was pretty much fearless about approaching adults when solving cases. He wasn't afraid to ask questions. And of course, the friendship between the three is great.
Hinter die Dinge zu gucken und natürlich die Freundschaft zwischen den dreien, das ist super.
The Three Investigators have been hugely popular in Germany for decades. To improve the film's international appeal, the producers cast American actors in the main roles.
You'll never guess in a million years where we're going next.
South Africa.
Sounds to me like a code white.
Vacation!
It was a little bit nerve-wracking at first, just, you know, knowing that everyone's so into it and so... They love it so much here and stuff, and knowing they'd watch every little detail about Pete and stuff.
At the Berlin premiere, the young audience was eagerly anticipating seeing their heroes brought to life on the silver screen. Studio Hamburg bought the rights for the film Beating Out Hollywood. The budget was just 11 million euros, but it looks much more expensive. The producers chose to shoot in South Africa to save money. But that wasn't the only reason to film there.
Skeleton Island is an episode where the boys go to the east coast of the US to a deserted island. That's hard to find these days. The story's from the 1960s, and we've made it contemporary.
I wanted to hire the three investigators to clear my father. I've got 200 rands here, all my savings.
Shooting in South Africa allowed Baxmeier to add a touch of social criticism. Some of the scenes were shot in a township in Cape Town. But at its core, the film is a kid's adventure tale, part Sherlock Holmes, part Indiana Jones.
I'd like to have had the budget of a James Bond film and had even more action scenes. I really wanted to make an entertaining family film that's a lot of fun, and action scenes are a part of that.
You ready, investigators? Code Crimson.
Unbelievably dangerous!
A self-portrait by Rembrandt. It was reported stolen from this gallery 6 months ago.
But the ingenious truth is that the painting never left this building.
Who are you?
We're the three investigators.
And how did the audience enjoy it?
I think it's great that it's sometimes scary. At first I thought they wouldn't be able to reproduce what the audiobooks provided and capture the characters, but I have to say the actors were really well chosen.
Sie sehen
gut aus.
They look good. They're really nice and they make the film exciting.
Shooting has begun on a sequel, and part three is planned. But with more than 100 novels published, the adventure could go on indefinitely.
And now for two very special films, 4 Minutes and Black Book. Both films are nominated for the European Film Prize, and you can win the DVDs.
erwischen sie, egal was.
Schieß!
Egal wie. Egal wo.
For a chance to win, just write to us and tell us how you like today's show. Here's the address. Deutsche Welle TV, Kino, Wolterstraße 6, 13355 Berlin. Email kino@dw-world.de. This is goodbye. Ute Suldira will be back next month with our year-end show. A look back at the best in German cinema 2007. Until then, have fun at the movies.